All right, we're here with DJ Rose and Chris Lain for a last Sparrow interview. I'll let you guys introduce yourselves.
This is Chris Lain.
That's each other.
This is DJ Rose. All right, let's get the basics about you guys. Where you from, age, how long you been tattooing, you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Chris is 45?
40.
Man, I'm old. You better introduce yourself.
Chris Lain, 40 years old. We've established that. And I've been tattooing for a little over 20 years. Mostly all of it in Texas. Corpus Christi, to be exact. And how about you?
I'm 45 years old, Chris. I didn't know I was that much older than you.
Yeah, that's not that much, though. In the whole grand scheme of things, it's not that much.
I tattoo in Syracuse, New York. I've had the shop for 17 years. I've been tattooing for 12. For the first five, I just ran the shop.
And what is the name of the shops you guys own?
I own Pinnacle Tattoo in Corpus Christi.
And Halo Tattoo in Syracuse and in Liverpool. Two shops.
Not England. Let's clarify
nope.
That.
Yep. Yep. That'd be awesome.
Yeah. So how do you guys know each other?
I think Salt Lake City, I don't know how many years ago, was the first introduction.
I missed a year because I had an ear infection, and I came back the next year, and everybody said that they didn't miss me because I had a replacement, and that I had to meet them. So that's how I met Chris. They're like, oh, this was you last year. You weren't here, so Chris did a stand-in, and he's staying, so.
Yeah.
And we went and got a coffee.
Yep.
We hung out, and then talked on the phone a bunch after that.
Yeah.
It was easy friendship.
And just to clarify, the reason why the interview with these two are together is because I've never seen either one without the other at a convention since I've known them. And kind of like two peas in a pod. And Chris doesn't talk a whole lot, and DJ does, so it kind of works out perfect.
No, Chris talks a lot. He's the fill-in, though. He doesn't get to talk. So DJ taps out.
Which by that time, usually I'm asleep.
And you're talking in your sleep.
I haven't known to do that.
Whoever wants to go first, what got you into tattooing? What was your first memories of tattooing, or like some of the first tattoos you ever saw?
You can start them.
I think that a big influence was when I went to a halfway house, and there was a guy there that was 5 years older than me, and he already had a few tattoos. And as soon as I turned 18, we did some research and found what we thought was, you know, the best shop in town, and that was kind of what kicked it into gear. I just looked up to him being tattooed, and I think over the course kind of really allowed me to focus on something, and I was definitely not going down the right path. That gave me a path and a direction and something to focus on, in a lot of ways, kind of, you know, saved my life really. So yeah, that was my start into it.
I just wanted to have a tattoo. I didn't have any intent other than getting like one tattoo. I went into a bunch of shops to figure out where I wanted to get it, and most of the shops didn't know much about it, but it didn't really speak anything to me. And then I found this guy that was tattooing. Now, I didn't find him. I'm not like Columbus or something. But I went into the shop in Auburn, and there was a guy who'd been there tattooing. He was this old Vietnam vet named Tattoo Tony. And he was different. All the other shops I had been into was, you know, people that they were older, but it didn't seem real. And Tattoo Tony was just, he was really rough around the edges. And I got my first tattoo from him, and I wanted to go back and get more. After I got that first one, I really wanted more. And he was gone because he had gotten a bunch of insurance money because someone ran into a shop with a car. And he went and kind of retired. And I met up with him years later in Atlanta. It was great. He's passed away now, but I think my first experience in that shop really made me want to get tattoos. So I didn't have any intent in being a tattooer, but that story's probably too long to tell. But let's just say that I only wanted to have a shop where people could come in upstate New York because there's no good shops. Tony was gone. There was this big vacuum for anything good, and the culture wasn't moving forward. I was keeping up with magazines and meeting a bunch of people from being on tour, and I just knew that tattooing was
what
so
year,
much bigger.
What
roughly that was like years? 93, 94, you know, like, I mean, I got my first tattoo in 91, okay, and I was touring with bands and meeting tattooers, you know, and being in San Francisco and being all over the place, and even in Europe, and just knowing how much bigger it was than what was going on where I was at, and no one was going to move it forward. So I just wanted to have a place where I could bring people in, like have a good base of tattooers there, but bring people in from the whole world over to kind of change what we had going on up there.
Was there any particular tattooers that time frame that you were, like, you kind of clinged on to, like you saw their style and that's what you wanted to emulate or kind of bring to that area, or just stood out to you more than any others?
Because of tattoo time, seeing that, I was just always drawn to like traditional or neo-traditional kind of stuff. And that's really what we pushed, because everything was kind of like, you weren't going to get anything drawn, you weren't going to get anything, and there's nothing wrong with that, but we just knew that people were doing this new take on old things. And, you know, I had been to like 222, and I had been to those places, you know, and I had been to Tattoo City, and I had been to Erno, like I was on tour, you know, and I knew people, I knew the guys when they started Jinx Proof from Sacramento.
Yeah.
And so, like, I didn't know a bunch of names per se. I'd been to Austin in the early 90s and just been in these shops, and I wasn't trying to find anybody's name out. I was just like, look at this.
Yeah.
I just wanted someone to be able to roll through our area and be like, look at this. And so, like, throughout my band, actually, we before we had the shop, we promoted traditional tattoos. We put out a record, and it was like the first ever hardcore record to prominently feature on the cover and throughout the layout traditional tattoo artwork. There was maybe rockabilly bands that were doing that stuff at the time, but my friend Banks did up all the tattoo designs based on old Flash. And in that music scene, no one was interested in that was promoting it and pushing it. And we were just so excited about it. We're like, we're going to put this out there. We started doing it on all our clothes and stuff, too.
Speaking of a Texas tattoo scene, like especially the Austin scene, you being from Texas, Chris, what was that something that you were drawn to a lot when you first got into tattooing?
In all honesty, when I first got into tattooing, you know, I was given, you know, the fundamentals, it was, you know, a street shop, a flash shop, it wasn't probably until a year and a half into tattooing that I really started paying attention to what was going on outside my little area. Yeah. I got tattooed by Timothy, which was an eye-opening experience to, you know, how to lay out big stuff, especially. Then I was, you know, really drawn to Trevino's work. I sought him out and started getting tattooed by him. And that was definitely, you know, a big influence. He opened my eyes to, just books and, you know, this person and that person and just, you know, all the people that I try to, you know, incorporate into, you know, what I do today. He was a big influence. Richard Stell, and I guess, you know, Bob Moreau, you know, he was, you know, Dave Lum, even, you know, Eric Doyle, had dinner with him tonight, and, you know, it's kind of nice talking about old Texas stuff, you know, when I run into him. So, yeah, those are big influences.
Seeing that Chris Trevino stuff now, his, you know, his Japanese stuff that he pretty much just solely does now is amazing.
Yeah.
But I don't think there's much that really compares to that old, his older style.
Yeah, the wacky stuff is amazing.
It's fucking mind-blowing.
Yeah, it's amazing. I started getting tattooed by him, I guess, about on the, you know, on the tail end of that. You know, he was doing starting to do a lot of Tibetan stuff at that time. And I've collected, Buddhist imagery, you know, from Tibet, from Japan, you know, from Bali, you know, so, a little bit of all of that stuff.
Talk to us a little bit about, like, the nature of touring and how music, like,
plays such a big role in the sort of transmission of visual images and how it sort of affects tattooing now and how it affected it then.
I think when you're a disaffected teen, as a lot of us were, you get, you don't belong here, you don't belong there, and you kind of, you know, some people get into gangs and do that, and some of us get into punk and stuff because it kind of becomes like a thing where it's like, it maybe if I look a little tougher, you know, I wouldn't have to fight as much, or I wouldn't have to get yelled at as much or whatever. So you get involved with that because of a look. It's an aesthetic, you know, like I want to have a mohawk and I want to have a leather jacket and all that stuff, and I, you know, had all that stuff. And then started seeing bands, and like, you know, they, if someone had like two big tattoos, you're like, oh my god, they got all these tattoos, you know. And you'd be like, I want to look like that, you know. So you pursue, in the beginning, it's just a look. And then for some of us, it just goes further, and you're just kind of like, why do I want to look like that? And like, we explore more. So, and then especially through touring, you get to meet the characters behind the people who are making album cover art. You know, that's affecting everybody worldwide. You know, I mean, how'd you feel the first time you saw a Cramps record cover? Unsettled. You know, you're like, that looks really cool, but it's kind of weird me out, you know?
I think, I mean, to a certain extent, I think that there was a whole time period where music had a huge part to play, like sort of pre-internet and all that kind of stuff, in the moving of, you know, kind of like what you were saying about touring, the moving of a tattoo aesthetic beyond the confines of a pretty narrow place, you know? It's like people were traveling all over, and then, you know, the fans of the music, like that disaffection or whatever, like it sort of started to snowball, you know. And now, I mean, I would say that, you know, with all that Warped Tour stuff and whatnot, like that has a huge part to play in kids getting heavily tattooed at this point.
Oh yeah, as mainstream as it was, that Red Hot Chili Peppers album was big influence.
Hell yeah.
You know, I took
thanks
that
to Hank for that.
Yeah, too. I mean, I took that cover and was like, I want this. Yeah. You know, just, you know, so huge part.
There was that one band with the Sun logo. Not saying their fucking names.
The R word.
Definitely not saying their names.
That's how culture moves ideas, though.
Yeah.
Like, you start out with three buddies in your basement. I think no one's going to care. You do it because where you live sucks. Or what else you got going on sucks. And you want to make something different, even if it's just for you and your buddies. And then you're affected by what you see and hear from other places, and you take what you have, and you spread your culture around. And it just, I would say, if nothing, the TV shows are the tail end of this, but what started it was the movement of bands in the late 80s and early 90s going from place to place, making up an actual web, not an internet web, but like a web of connectedness between people, staying at people's houses, getting tattooed out of kitchens, and then those people establishing themselves in shops. And each region, like, it would have a regional sound, had a regional look to its tattooing based on tradition and what you took your spin on it.
Yeah.
And it spread like that. Like, over from like 91 to 97, like, tattooing. And all those punk tattooers are all the, you know, all the guys that we loved, you know?
Yeah, and I think it's something to be said for the fact that, you know, there were people in bands that, you know, that next generation of kids really looked up to, you know, and thought were the ultimate, like, were counter people at, you know, shops and getting tattooed the fuck up and by great tattooers. And I mean, that's like an element of that it's growing beyond that sort of those sort of first steps, you know, when it was somebody like Lal Hardy in London tattooing all the skinheads in the 70s and 80s, you know, to the furthering of the punk rock movement in America, and like somebody like Henry Rollins being perceived as the most heavily tattooed man ever. And
sure.
Kind of
look
at him now and it's like, he's like, ain't that dude.
But that's the thing, if you're like in a touring band, you go through places three times a year, you go and someone's got one tattoo. You go back, they've got a sleeve. You go back and they're like halfway covered, like a year later, you're like, this is going on, you know? It's like everybody is seeing it and loving it. It just grew so much so quick. And that's cool.
Yeah.
Well, that's part of the thing that I think is really interesting about tattooing as well. It's like, not only is there that web of interconnectedness in, you know, music, but there's also a web of interconnectedness in our personal relationships with each other and our customers. You know, our customers become, you know, part of our lives to where they'll call us and be like, hey, I'm in this state, who do I mess with?
Yep.
And, you know, and then you, that web kind of keeps growing as well. And,
I mean, I've sent so many people to you guys and stuff, you know, it's like, if you're here, get tattooed by this person. If you're here, of course. That's what we want to do, you know. Yeah. You gotta look out for.
I think that's what started our relationship off too. Jeremy, was you referring that guy, you know, that moved over
Grits.
To Corpus from.
Give him a shout out.
Who ended up getting something really
weird,
cool.
You know, being so close to a military base, those guys get stationed. You know, they're at my spot for a couple years, and they move somewhere else. And I don't know how the military works, but for some reason we end up with a lot of people from Texas.
Yeah.
And they're always like, once they get tattooed a couple of times, they're like, oh, where do I go? And I'm like, if you're in Corpus Christi, go to this shop.
Yeah.
You know?
Houston here, Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, talk a little bit about that. Like, for many of us, you know, that we're in awe of Texas tattooing.
Yeah.
We know the idea of Texas tattooing. But we don't know the specifics of Texas tattooing. We were sort of talking a little bit about, you know, our knowledge of, you know, Austin, Dallas, you know, Houston, Corpus, I guess, you know, and not knowing, like, I'm sure it's hard to break down the whole history, but there's a huge interconnected Texas web that's grown out from that.
Yeah, and to be totally honest, I'm not sure I have all the history down correct.
Well, sure.
So, you know, I don't know. I just know that, you know, Sean Deegan and Chris had, you know, were taking over Perfection in San Antonio. And you know, that shop was a big influence on Texas tattooing. I think, though, that, again, Richard Stell, you know, because those guys, from what I understand, I know for sure Chris and I think Sean as well, got a bunch of work from him, you know. He was definitely the guy in Houston. Dan Martin is another one in Houston that does great work and, you know, has contributed a lot. Man, there are just so many people that
who
are part of it that
the
I don't
guy
even.
From Fort Worth. There was
know,
the one tattoo from Fort Worth too.
Tattooed all the Pantera guys.
Yes. He was all.
Man,
like, he picked up any fucking early '90s tattoo magazine.
I
want to
say it was Randy.
Yes.
Shoot, man. Randy Adams. That's it. It was Randy Adams. You heard that thrown around a whole lot. The Shaws. Man, I kicked myself, you know, regularly from not. I mean, you know, Old Man Shaw was still tattooing whenever I started. You know, and I, you know, just ignorant, didn't know. You know, and I never collected one, but. Yeah, that was 45 minutes from where I started, you know, right.
And wasn't there kind of a connection between Houston, Austin, and Dallas? Like a, you know, sort of, what was...
Well, I think that, but I think it was Richard kind of Houston and Dallas, from what I understand. And then, you know, Chris was back and forth between San Antonio and Austin. Lum was still there when Lum left. Then Chris, you know, was more full time in Austin, from what I understand, or for what I remember. That was when about the time I started getting tattooed by him. I don't know of any other connection other than that.
Okay, I guess we shouldn't leave out Mike Malone. You know, as long as we're talking about Texas tattooers.
Yeah, true. But you
minor
know, but,
footnote
but,
in the history of tattooing, I suppose.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, and the crazy thing is, to me, it's kind of how much he impacted, not just with tattooing, but, you know, kind of the visual aesthetic in Austin with that stuff for, like, the Austin Chronicle, all those covers. I mean, the Day of the Dead covers he was doing, which I think you can still write to them and get copies of. It's pretty cool that, you know, he created a look for a place. And then, you know,
Yeah.
like, Texas has had a massive impact on
Texas. Yeah, that's why I say, I mean, I'm
sure
there's so many dimensions, you know, that yeah, it's hard to
Richard cover. Stell told me once that he introduced tribal tattooing to Houston, and specifically to Texas. He brought tribal tattooing. It was pretty remarkable to think of in that time period, you know?
Yeah, yeah. We were doing a lot of that.
Yeah.
Beach town, lots of tribal on bands.
I miss those days, though.
Yeah.
Miss them.
Yeah.
I'd still do them. People pop up in the shop. I'd do them all day long if I could now. It's simple.
Autopilot.
You ain't got nothing to, it's just a next. Simple yeah. to do. Miss those days, some days.
So I guess I could transition into another question about the shift that you've seen in tattooing, you know, since you started versus what you see going on today, and maybe, you know, what you see some of the future of it holding.
Hmm. That's a lot to cover.
I think the difference in style you guys have, like with the style DJ has in tattooing, I think it would be really hard for yours to translate to what the more popularized tattooing is today, though.
I just can't concern myself with things I can't do. You know?
I think that...
I just don't care.
The best answer
Fair
ever.
Play.
I love that.
I just do the thing I do, and...
Yeah.
Otherwise, I mean, I still do tribal armbands. I do lower back tattoos. I do kanji off the wall. I do Pinterest. Whatever you bring into me, if I can do it, there's a lot of stuff I can't do.
Yeah.
If I can do it, I do it, and... I do custom ones when I'm asked. I really love doing them. But if I got asked too much, I just can't pull that rabbit out of the hat every time. So sometimes I put people off and say, yeah, can I get this drawn and get back to you?
Yeah.
Because I try to...
I mean, do you... Like, with being a college town, though, a big college town where you're at, do you find yourself doing more and more of that style of stuff? Or do you find, because it is a college town, more, I guess, you, for lack of a better term, like, more educated people that are getting more sophisticated
stuff? No, it's all starters. It's all starters every year, so it's... You know, 6 months of bird silhouettes, 6 months of infinity symbols. By the time I get good at them, they switch up to something else. I got to relearn. I'm like, I finally got good at the bird silhouette. I finally made it so you can tell the beak apart from the neck. After all this time, I finally used the right gauge needle. Because I use gauges.
You know? Gauges.
Yeah. Y'all got gauges? Yeah, I got gauges. And then they switch it up. But we always tried it. We always... try to find patient zero is what we do when any new trend comes in. Mm. I get a hold of our piercer and I say, find patient zero. Find out why everyone's getting this tattoo in this spot. Because that's what interests me. You know, where's the jump off point for this particular, you know, the Rihanna tattoo or the Britney Spears, you know, and you get to know it after a while. But like, I'm always just like, what, this new trend? It's like, I mean, I don't care what it is. It's going to be something.
Yeah.
No matter what, I'm pulling out this, and I'm doing this, and then I'm doing this. You know?
Did you meet the guy that started the mustache trend?
Tim?
Mm-hmm. You did. Here tonight.
Yeah.
I heard it was Katie Seligren, to be honest.
He's claiming.
I heard that Dan did it.
He told me.
Someone told me that the other day. Do you have any knowledge of that?
Higgs doing a mustache?
On Katie's finger. Someone just told me that the other day. Because you said Tim, and I was like, I just heard just the other day it was Katie. Don't know.
Crazy. Controversial claims of being me.
Does anyone really need to claim that? I
mean, well, if we're looking for patient, if we're looking for patient zero, if we're looking for the patient zero, that's important. But if not, it's not.
Feel free to leave comments in the sections below on who you think the original mustache finger tattooer is.
I've never tattooed one. I can tell you that.
Wow. I've done enough to not ever want to do them again. Or I just simply explain, like, hey, it's a bad idea. It's not going to stay. You're not going to get a free touch-up. Do you really want to spend the money on this?
Well, DJ touched on that. It's amazing how fast those trends change now because of the internet. You know, yeah. I mean, it used to take traveling around in a band for a year before you saw the next trend that came around. And now it's...
The birds. I'd love to do the birds every day now.
It's, you know, it's...
I got them. The birds.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are awesome tattoos.
I remember the first the first time I saw those on someone that was, I guess, more of a popularized that you would see on a normal basis on television was on the singer
Sugar
Ray. Sugar
Ray. Yeah.
And then once that was like the popular band at the time, and it was on MTV constantly, I was doing them, you know, 4, 5, 6 a week.
Yeah.
And
yeah, customers coming in asking for good Charlotte birds.
Punk rock stars.
Punk rock star is my ultimate punk favorite. Rock stars. Or NorCal star.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I've had people call Stray Edge stars too, which.
Whatever label they can attach to it.
Sure.
Yeah.
Whatever makes them feel better about
it. But that's the thing, it's all the same thing, but the reason why somebody gets it is what they connect to it.
Yeah.
You know, that's the whole thing, is you get 5 people getting the same thing, and to each person it means something different. That's why people come in and they say, do you get sick of doing butterflies? I'm like, A, I'm never sick of feeding my family. B, I don't care what people are getting, not that I don't care, but the meaning's for them. I have no idea. I don't put the meaning into it. They develop it. I've got just like designs on me and stuff. They don't mean anything. What they mean is I wanted to have a tattoo that looked cool. Yeah, I wanted to feel cool, and that's how I wanted to do it. So I don't like be like, oh, this infinity symbol, stupid. To that person, that means something, and that's not stupid. That's just snobbery. Yeah. You know, it's like, you know, 5 girls come in, they want to get a tattoo, they're sharing an experience. Don't demean their experience. It has nothing to do with you. Just apply it, do your job and apply it. You know, that's what, I mean, we've got great people who work in our shop, and, you know, I say, if they come up and just don't belittle people, don't give people an attitude over something that they want to pay you to do, your job. Because they don't need you.
Right.
You need them.
That's true.
They feed you, you know? You get like that, and you're just like, then you get bummed when you're not doing tattoos.
That's true.
You can't bitch both ways. It's stupid.
Which kind of touched on another topic. You guys both being business owners, fathers, and long-term tattooers, and a couple of the greatest dads I've ever met in my entire life. What's it like being a business owner, and this is your career, and providing and having a family and trying to balance being a tattooer lifestyle everybody wants it to be, and being
it's like a family about man. 90 hours a week.
You're working too hard.
It's about 90 hours, you know, on a long week. No, it's staying busy. Is what keeps me going. So, I want to be good at what I do, and so, I put on my plate what I have time to be good at, and or try to be good at, and just play the balance game. Brian knows about that.
The hardest game there is.
Man, it is. It's a hard game when you got a bunch of irons in the fire, and you know, keep the wife happy, keep the kids happy, keep yourself happy.
And then it evolves to something else.
Yeah.
Adapt to that.
Yep. That's the one thing about having kids. As soon as you get used to one routine, that routine changes, and then you got to get, you know, whether it's up at 6:30 in the morning to get them to basketball practice, or you're picking them up an hour and a half after school's over because they had a game, or, you know, whatever the case may be, or, you know, so, it's a bit of a juggling act, but I wouldn't have it any other way. I like the time that I spend, working and being a husband, being a father. What about you?
My problem is I like everything I do. Like, if I'm at work, I love being there. I've got all these ideas. Like, come the end of the night, I'm like, is it 9 o'clock already? You know, like, I've got this stuff. Like, now that I'm done with this work, I've got these ideas I want to get out. When I'm at home, I don't want to go to work. It's like, no matter where I'm at, it's like, I don't want to leave the kids. What do? Can I just cancel my appointment? And it's like, some people always want to be somewhere else, and I always want to be where I'm at. So it's kind of the opposite problem. But like, I think that I found a pretty fair balance with being a dad and stuff. Because now I'll go into work a lot later, and I don't usually go in until I have appointments. So I spend time with my wife during the day. Besides just being at night, I do all my painting and stuff at home now instead of doing it at the shop. And, you know, like you said, all this takes thinking, you know, because if something ain't working, you gotta figure out something else to do. But I know that the thing that is going to have to change at some point, I won't be able to work weekends at all because my kids are getting older and I can't just have just a Sunday with them.
Yeah.
You know? So that's going to take Saturday's a busy day, so that's going to take money out. So, but, you know, some...
Yeah.
Where do you lose? It's like somebody's got to lose, and I think the money's got to lose after a while.
Yeah, when it comes down to it, it'll all be taken care of. You just got to pick your priorities. That's what I find myself doing more and more now. Even though I'm not a business owner, I still find myself like, oh, I'll just...
Yeah, but you're still running your business out of a business. I mean, it's like, you know, it's like you got to handle it, you know, like you would if it was your business. Yeah. So, independent contractor, you know.
I solely base my appointments around, at this point, on how much time I want to spend with my kids. Because they're so young.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, I want to do this and this day, so I'm going to, you know, put it in my book before I make my appointments for this particular week, and I'm going to schedule around this because that's what I want to do. But it's like, you know, the hype of being a tattooer and how, you know, cool it is that the younger people see in tattooing never really think of it in that aspect. Like, in the long term, if you eventually have a family, like, trying to balance that coolness in a family is virtually impossible. Something that eventually has to kind of go out of that.
Well, just equation. Don't worry about being cool. It's a whole lot easier.
I tell everybody all the time, tattooing isn't as cool as they think it is.
No, being cool isn't even cool.
It's a
just being a dad's pretty damn cool.
Yeah,
you know,
being responsible and taking care of business.
Getting paid to do what you love is cool. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
People are like, did you do anything cool today? I'm like, is feeding my kids cool? Because that's what I did today. I went in and I did the job that I was asked to do, and I brought the money home and fed everybody.
Yeah.
How was cooler than that? You know, and you do that no matter what, even if it wasn't a tattoo, or it doesn't matter what you're doing. You should just love, find something you love and do it.
Yep. I think that's why, you know, I said earlier it saved my life is because I found something that I love to do. And, you know, I didn't draw whenever I first started tattooing, but, you know, the influence that I had, you know, I wanted to have the ability to, when somebody came in with an idea, be able to give it to them. And, tattooing gave me the focus to, you know, for me to, you know, put time into something that made me feel good about what I was doing. Giving the customer, you know, something that they wanted that I knew was going to, you know, stand the test of time. Well, the stuff in the beginning definitely didn't stand the test of time, but it evolved into tattoos that would stand the test of time.
I don't think anybody's like their first couple years of tattooing.
Oh, a couple.
Five. I think the tattooing, the hardest part about being a tattooer, it really kind of boils down to anything that you do that you're creating, is you don't get to leave it behind when you leave work. Mm-hmm. That's the major, I think that's what causes the burnout eventually, and that's what makes the juggle so hard. Because even when you're not at work, even if you're not drawing, you're sitting there watching TV.
Drawing it in your head.
You're thinking about it. You don't get to walk away.
Yeah.
People who work in an office or whatever, Friday hits.
And it's the weekend.
They're out.
Yeah.
They don't think about it till Monday. You know what I mean? And so it's like, you don't get that. I mean, there's plenty of other professions I think are the same. But, you know, tattooing certainly is, if you try to be good at it, you know, and you work hard and you love it, you know. So it's like you throw that mix in with your children and your wife and you know what I mean? And it's like you're constantly pulled in many directions, you know what I mean? And it's like that's where it becomes a real struggle, you know.
Yeah.
That's the hardest part. Like,
yeah.
I think because you guys work on such a bigger scale that it's a lot harder for you. For me, I've always got concepts and stuff popping into my head. I can write those down on a piece of paper or something like that. But you are really working a lot harder than me, to be honest. Because I'm not drawing a back piece.
Yeah, but
I'm not worried about grand layouts and what's going to happen. My tattoos are going to be 4 or 5 hours the longest.
Still, but I think you work differently.
I definitely do.
There's
because when I'm reading, I'm working on tattoos.
Absolutely, and you're coming up with concepts, and like you said, pulling a rabbit out of the hat, same kind of situation that Higgs had, and where it's like, you're doing thinking people's tattoos, and everything has meanings, and everything has you know, these things are all coordinating together to create this whole thing. And, you know, the average dipshit is going to look at that and have no clue what any of it
is. No one gives a shit.
So, but people who think about it and they think about, you know, these symbols, because that's all any of this is, you know, is like, that's a lot of work. Whether you're actually putting pencil to paper or not is, you know.
But yeah. I know with you guys, like Grez, like he gets home at 11 and draws till 4 in the morning. I couldn't do it. I
think,
I
think him, he's a perfect example. Because he does, I mean, he does plenty of big tattoos, but he does a lot of hand size or, generally speaking, you know, large but not giant tattoos. I'll have 3 weeks where I don't have to draw a single thing. It's rare, but sometimes it lines up like that. But you have to draw 3 tattoos that are this big every night for your 3 appointments the next day.
Yeah.
That's a lot of work. You know what I mean? And that's a lot to deal with. And I can have, you know, 2 or 3 sleeves to do during a week or whatever and stagger that out to work out pretty easily where I don't, it's not stacking up like that. So I think that.
And in those days you have to draw, you can just schedule nothing but shading clouds.
Yeah.
And then you're not burned out and you can go home. Yeah. You feel free to draw.
I've had whole weeks where you've done the background. Yeah. This way it lines up, you know? But it's like, you know, I just think that the work is going in different places.
Sure.
You know? I don't have time to sit down and read a book and think about, you know, a lot of these things. You know what I mean? But it's like, I think that it's awesome. And I think that, you know, putting that forethought into it is an amazing thing, but it's also work. And it's like whether it takes you just as long to do that and put it to paper and create an image as it does for me to draw a fucking snake. You know what I mean? Because it's just like, it's no different. It's just, you know.
But also thinking in the same sense, in a snake drawing, it's easier to fix a simple mistake on that or even a large mistake. You can just kind of go with it because it's on a large scale. I think with your stuff, DJ, I think if one line is wrong, it's really hard to get a small image like that the way you draw it perfect.
Thankfully I'm not going for perfect.
I mean, I don't
see any mistakes in any of my tattoos, because here's the thing, I have a different goal in mind. If it doesn't look the way, if it's not working out the way I want to, I'm gonna make it work. Tom DeVita says pull it out of the fire. I'm doing it all the time. Right. I'll be going and I'll be like, oh well, okay, this is what I can do. That's where the black goes, you know, or whatever. It's as long as it looks at the end, I'm happy with it. Almost anything can happen. Right. Like people are like, you ever mess up a tattoo? And I'm like, not one that I drew, because I can do. I always tell people the purple lines that are on you are merely suggestions of what might happen in this experience, of this tattoo.
But I look at
any point, I can go. Like a straight line could be like, wow, you know, and like make it work.
It, like in the stuff you draw and the stuff like larger scale, like Japanese stuff. When I look at it, to me, what you do is harder.
Oh yeah.
Because I mean, there's every little.
I get nervous. Oh yeah. I do a heart on a girl's wrist. I'm more nervous.
With the way it's drawn, if it doesn't have the right size line weight, if the gaps between certain things aren't just right,
but that's
makes
what
it
I
look
find
weird,
easy.
Though.
Those are the things I find easy. So for me, it's not something I sweat.
I think in your work, like there's definitely something to be said about the fact that there are a lot of people who struggle to have a visual vocabulary, and then they sort of figure out what they're trying to express once they've had a sort of canonized set of images that they're working with, where it's almost the opposite for you. You have something that you want to say. And through time, you have learned to apply that to a visual language that you make your images from, you know? And I think that instead of pushing around cool shapes until something happens, you know, you have a clear point of view and something really interesting to speak on that deals with, you know, a lot of your life and your personal beliefs and whatnot without being pushy or anything like that. It's a celebration of life, you know? And it's something that is inspirational for the fact that I see tons of people that their stuff is more or less a celebration of their own ego. It doesn't have anything to do with the person wearing it or, you know, something larger than, you know, the experience in general. So, I mean,
I think that anything that people might find strong about my work is me working around my weakness. I can't draw faces, so I have to find a way to express what would be expressed in a face by not doing a face, you know? And anything that people think is interesting about my work is just me simply trying to find a way to express what people want me to say with it in a way that I can be happy with it and not try to screw up somebody else's version of that. And I've had to develop like a real way of doing things, and I'm happy to do so. And I think that, like, you know, like I'm always drawing a skull, a heart, or a flower, mostly hearts and everything, like I'm a teenage girl.
There's a heart.
But I think that that's what I'm trying to say, is these things come from these images that, like, they snap into your brain, you know. And what I do isn't for everybody, but it doesn't bug me, you know. I do walk-in tattoos, and I do special ones for special people.
It's also kind of like you're tapping into something that Brian was saying, is it's a set of symbols too, and you know, even with the patient zero idea and all that, like, there's something going on, you know, the sort of alchemy of, you know, symbols translating into ideas which resonate with people on a deeper level. You know, that sort of impact of a heart and how it represents love. Now, love can be interpreted in many different ways, but you see that image, you see that symbol, and it's become the symbol. And so, you know, you can put that in your work, and that instantly calls that to mind. And you've worked up a number of images beyond what most people kind of play with, that you're playing with and putting them together in really interesting Lego blocks to express both people's ideas and your own ideas, that, you know, the special things that you make for people, which is really cool.
Thank you.
Fucking mind blown right there, Dave. Fucking keep putting it down, man. Preaching that shit.
And Chris Lane, on the other hand, probably the most prepared tattooer I've ever known.
Did you prepackage everything that you needed to use, like, setup-wise, like, in Ziploc bags? Like, one dental bib, one razor.
I came.
Is that a George Thorogood song?
No. But I did see someone...
One dental bib, one razor.
I did see someone at the convention this weekend who prepared, in Ziploc bags, one dental bib, one razor, one little package of, like, Vaseline, ink caps... So when there was a tattoo to do, instead of, like, having this shit scattered everywhere.
I showed up with my machines, and that was it. Thanks to my good friends, I was able to...
accumulate the rest of the belongings.
Borrow, beg, and steal the rest of what I needed to perform my duties this weekend.
When I say prepared, though, I mean, you work really hard on being prepared for people's drawings. You think about them well in advance. You're definitely not one of those kind of, like...
You're not like me.
You're not slapping it together at the last minute, you know?
I know that I see sketches you send me a week ahead of time. You're like, oh, I gotta do this next week. This is, you know, you send me, like, a detail of a bigger drawing.
Do you find yourself more enthused about certain tattoos, and then you draw them way in advance?
No, I definitely do that, but I also draw them in advance because, man, I never know what's gonna come up, you know? See, as far as, like... You know, with the business, this might happen, or with personal life, that might happen, or, you know, if my schedule is booked out a few months in advance, and then all of a sudden, you know, I've got basketball games to attend on Tuesday night when I planned on doing drawing, you know, so that's a lot of the reason why I draw them in advance.
I find myself overanalyzing everything too much if I draw it way too far in advance. If I stare at it too long, I want to go back and change a lot of stuff.
I'll draw it, and then I don't even look at it until right beforehand, and I'll make any little refinements and then just do my line drawing off of that. I don't sit and stare at it and pick it apart, because I'll do the same thing. But sometimes I've got a lot of stuff coming up that week, and so it's easier for me to get the drawing done beforehand.
You guys being tattooers for, you know, 20-plus years now, throughout the years of tattooing, is there any particular tattooers, while you guys were coming up younger to even now, that really stand out in your minds as, you know, like, like an influence to you in tattooing?
Well, I don't know. In the beginning, one of my biggest influences was my boss, Bruce Edwards. I mean, I guess the usual suspects that I don't even need to name.
Kevin Spacey.
Yes.
The Baldwin dude.
Yes.
Kaiser
Soze. Cannot leave out Kaiser Soze because that would.
He was a big influence.
Yes.
He was.
He was a big influence.
Did you ever see him though?
At the end.
I'm not going to go back and watch that movie again.
His limp goes away. He walks on.
Oh, that's fucking.
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert. We got to label this as
Yoda spoiler. Dies. The North winds.
What about you, DJ? Who are some of your favorite tattooers throughout the years and even.
Man, my list is the one that people give. You know what I'm saying? Look up the dudes that tattoos like I do and like read their list, cross reference it. It's, you know, Dan's the mind blower because when I saw that tattoo time, I was getting tattooed by my friend Banks, and I just wanted to have tattoos. I just wanted to have as much stuff cover my skin as possible. And he had these magazines, these books, and I was just like, oh, you can do them different? You know, like yeah. Different people do them different. You don't just bring a guy a drawing. And I was flipping through that, and I saw Dan's stuff, and I was like, what is that? I need that. That's what I need. Stop what you're doing. Because I'm going to find this guy, and I started writing him letters and tried to get tattooed by him because that's what I wanted to have. So concurrently, I was reading books on architecture and art and things like that because Banks had my head spun on this, oh, you know why this doorway is shaped like this, you know, or you know why there are this many windows in this part of this church, and I was just like seeing everything everywhere, you know?
Yeah.
Why is this sign an octagon and that one a triangle, you know, to get your attention. Why, you know, yellow and black? And I wasn't even a graphic artist or anything. I was just interested. Why is yellow and black the biggest contrast on a sign that's going to get your attention? Why do they make certain restaurants so you want to get out and certain other restaurants so you want to stay? What are people trying to say with architecture and symbols to get your mind to work a certain way and to put you in a certain place? So if you can do that with a building, you can do that with yourself, and you can use tattooing to make yourself better. Getting tattoos.
Right.
You know, and I wanted that, you know? And I didn't even want a tattoo, I just wanted to have ones that made me feel awesome. And so when I wanted to make them, I wanted to make ones that made people feel awesome. Which is why I want to do the infinity symbol good. Because I want that person to leave and be like, what just happened? Like, I'm a different, I'm a beautiful and unique snowflake. You know, yeah. This is me. This is, you know, and they leave with their friends and their day's better. And
that's a really
40
cool
years
thing.
Later, they're like, I got this tattoo when I was in college and like, it was just BS and we just went and did this thing. But like, man, I miss those people. And that was really fun. It's like a time capsule, you know, it's like, yeah. Can be all these things, or it can just be a lame, shitty job.
I've watched it change people dramatically. I did a leg sleeve on a lady that dressed super frumpy and just kind of, you know, she never brushed her hair and, you know, she never, you know, she always just dressed in, you know, blah clothes and whatnot. And by the end of that leg sleeve, she was wearing makeup, wearing shorter skirts. And
she
like,
feels positive
oh, yeah,
about herself,
she felt,
positive body
she
image.
She felt really good about herself by the end of that thing. And she pops in the shop periodically to say hey and, you know.
What was the first tattoo you got?
First tattoo I got.
Where, what part of your body was it on?
Upper.
Did you pull your sleeve up more?
Yeah. Never wore more tank tops in my life.
That's just because you're in Corpus
and
Christi,
then,
right?
Yeah, that, yeah. And then when I brought it down past the elbow, man, I paid for everything with that forearm. Yeah. You know, like, and I got all my change with that forearm.
It's
know?
Like when you check out in the grocery store and everybody, the person wants to show you their tongue ring to show you their down. Like, and you're like, I got it. You and me, we're the same. The guy pulls up next to you in the muscle car, starts revving his engine. You look over, he's got the yin yang tattoo, yes. And he's like, yeah. And you're like, brother, me and you against the world, man.
Yeah. So we're coming to an end here. What is your, you guys' contact info and how can people get in touch with you guys about getting tattooed? Or
it's really hard to get a hold of people now to get tattooed because lack of information.
It's true. Lack of internet, lack of
telephones. So I've got this mysterious website called Google, and it can pretty much tell you anything. But it's,
you can type in,
don't tell that many people about
it. Halo tattoo, Syracuse, New York.
You could probably just screenshot my face, and there's a program that'll bring up my whole history.
Facial recognition.
Yeah.
It is out there.
And just so everybody knows, his shop's been around a lot longer than that fucking stupid video game, so don't get the two confused.
But I did not get bummed when it got released, because just having the name around.
Oh, yeah. I guess, yeah. Googling hate, yeah, that would...
Yeah. No, there's no bad advertising.
It's true. I never
thought of it. Like, when it came out, I was like, oh, there's a game named after the shop now, so everyone's going to have this positive feeling about the name.
It's true.
It doesn't stop people from mispronouncing it, though. Y'all work at Halo's? Yeah, Halo's. Or Hollow? Yes, I've named myself after geographical depression. A hollow. It doesn't even make any sense.
Like a hollow?
Yeah, we won't even into some of the names that...
I want to say it, but I'm not going to.
Say it. So, now you got to say it. Brian Bruno, you got to say it.
The P-knuckle. The P-knuckle tattoo. You work at that P-knuckle? P-knuckle tattoo.
You sound like Chad when you say that. It looks like Chad voice.
I just automatically went into Birmingham.
Wow.
Anyway, pentacletattoo.net.
Awesome.
We have a website, but like, who looks at websites? So.
What about Instagram then?
I got an Instagram.
DJ Rose. Yeah.
Good for you. I know.
Is anybody watching this far into the video? If you are, comment that you've watched the whole video.
Yes, that you watched the whole thing, and yeah, let us know. By
hey,
I'm gonna say, what's up,
Chris? If they were quiet in the back, it'd be a whole lot easier to check whether or not this was picking up our voice.
That ain't gonna happen.
Probably not.